jago kayak gitu. Tapi kita nanti kita yang kan kayak
good afternoon, everyone. As we prepare to begin our service to celebrate the life of Ms. Kimberly Rajkumar, I invite us to stand as we bring the casket to the front of the church. Just to take our seats.
Life is like a mighty sea, so tossed and driven. Billows rise within the hearts of every man. Storms so many times will leave the heart with questions. I don't need to understand, just hold his hand. I don't need to understand, I just need to hold his hand. I don't ever need to ask the reason why, for I know he'll make a way through the night and through the day. I don't need to understand, just hold his hand. When my life down here is through, someday he'll call me to my home up there upon the golden. and shore. I look back, review the past that lay before me. Then I won't need to understand anymore. I don't need to understand. I just need to hold his hand. I don't ever need to ask the reason why. For I know he'll make a way through the night and through the day. I don't need to understand, just hold his hand. We don't need to understand, we just need to hold his hand. We don't ever need to ask the reason why. For we know he'll make a way through the night and through the day. We don't need to understand, just hold his hand.
We indeed do not need to understand. We are to just trust and hold his hand. Friends, hear the words of Scripture and may they bring comfort to us. The eternal God is your dwelling place and underneath are the everlasting arms. Psalm 46, Psalm which we know so very well, begins and tells us, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in times of grief, in times of sorrow, in times of loss, in times of trouble. Verse 10 of that psalm, we know well, say it with me. Be still and know that I am God. Book of Ecclesiastes says to us, for everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die. A time to plant and a time to pluck up what is planted. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to seek and a time to lose. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to tear and a time to repair, to sow. A time to keep silence and a time to speak. A time to love and a time to hate. A time for war and a time for peace. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven. Jesus said, and these words printed on the front of our program, my peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your heart be troubled. Do not let them be afraid. Let's bow our heads for a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, as we come to celebrate the life of our dear Kimberly, we come to seek your comfort and strength. As we gather as family, as friends, as members of the church, we ask, Heavenly Father, that you be with us. Be with us as we worship. Be with us as we remember, as we reflect, as we rejoice. Be with us as we celebrate a life of someone who was gracious and grateful, compassionate, simple, humble, and always positive. Someone who was faithful to the end. We ask, O God, that as we lift our voices in song, that you bring to us comfort through the words that we sing. As we bow our heads in prayer, O God, we ask that you hear the agony and the anguish, the sadness of our hearts, and give to us that joy and that peace. And as we listen to your word read and proclaimed, remind us that you are the God who in Christ Jesus has won for us victory over the grave, and that the casket does not have that final say, but that there is life eternal and everlasting. And our dear Kimberly has gone to be with you. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, bless us in this time of worship and receive our prayers as we offer this, the blessed name of our living Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. At this time, as we think about Kimberly's life and as we think of the impact that she has had upon us, the influence that she was able to exert and her time here on this side of eternity, as we think about the relationship that we have with her, we, as I'm sure, would have shared memories and moments, expressed sentiments for the last few days. At this time, we will have our eulogy read for us as we listen to members of the family share a little deeper insight and share Kimberly's life here on this side of eternity with us. So the eulogy will be read for us at this time.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Kimberly, one of the sisters of Kimberly. On behalf of Carrie and I, we are here to pay tribute to our dear sister, Kimberly. Kimberly was 9 years older than us. She was born on Friday, October 14th, 1983. When we were thinking about this tribute, we found out that 131,547,856 babies were born throughout the year. And on 14th October 1983, approximately 360,405 babies were born. Along with so many families, Kedar and Diane welcomed their firstborn child into the world. Our Kimmy, as most of you know, would be dramatic when she wanted to be. We believe the way she entered this world had something to do with it. The story was told to us by our father that on the day of her birth, the elevator at San Fernando General Hospital was out of order. So he had to bodily pick up his darling wife, and run up the stairs to the maternity ward. He also said while they were filling out the paperwork, Kimberly made her appearance. So my mother never made it to the delivery room. This set the mood for Kimberly's life. Our mother Diane says she was a willing and most helpful child with a bright and bubbly smile. No matter the circumstances, she was always there to assist in any way she could offer. And our father Katie describes her as the joy of his life because this was his firstborn child. As a young couple, they had their challenges. And during those times, it was obvious how Kimberly tenaciously craved her parents' attention. She would relish the time she spent with each of them. Kimberly was a very emotional child growing up. While growing up, we heard stories about how engrossed she would become in the things which held her interest. Her passionate outbursts are incidents our mother would speak about over and over. For example, one of her favorite TV shows was Baywatch. And on this particular episode, one of the main characters named Jill died. Little Kimberly was so grieved, she ran outside crying, "Jill dead, Jill dead." When our mother and grandmother came to her very concerned, it took them a while to figure out who Jill was, but that was our sister. Kimberly became an older sister on January 24, 1993, in which she displayed her motherly skills very efficiently and continued to do so to the very end. She would oftentimes pack our lunch bags, including her sweet snacks she thoroughly enjoyed. The motherly affection continued when our nieces, Isabel and Catalina Grangaram, frequented our home. As she got older, she enjoyed Indian movies. The first movie she ever looked at was Kuch Kuch Hota Hai in 1998, and she fell in love with Shah Rukh Khan. Her first wall poster she hung on her bedroom wall was a picture of him she found in the daily newspapers. Her love affair with him continued over the years as she made sure she saw every movie he starred in. Unfortunately, it was during her teenage years that Kimberly started to experience health issues. There were many visits to various doctors to determine the cause of her illness. In her early 20s, the root cause of her illness was discovered. Kimberly needed a kidney transplant. This too happened quickly, and our mother lost no time in making the decision to donate the life-saving organ. God truly led the way through this tumultuous time in Kimmy's life, as everything fell into place so smoothly. The surgery was successful, and Kimberly was assured some normalcy in her already complicated life. Our sister lived a restricted lifestyle until Kerry and I became of age. One night we decided to go Space La Nuba. Only God knows how Daddy allowed us to go and how he even dropped us. On entering the nightclub, it was pitch black, so it took a few minutes to adjust to the setting. So I looked around to see Kimberly, and I didn't see her around. Upon looking again, she popped up out of nowhere. Like, where did you go? I fall down. Well, I started to laugh. She said, I want to go home. I said, no, you're not going anywhere. We included her in so many of our escapades, so at least she would share in the many experiences young people would have growing up. Kimberly not only seemed to find purpose in her life, but also impacted the lives of others. When she made the decision to serve the Presbyterian Church as a minister, she was committed to her studies and thoroughly enjoyed the various activities of the church. She made numerous friends and fostered relationships which she always cherished. In her morning routine, she would send inspirational messages to her WhatsApp contacts. We were told by some of them that when she did not send any of her messages, they knew something was wrong. Sometimes it seems as if life can be unfair, as it was during her last year of her studies that she was diagnosed with end-stage renal failure. Kimberly endured approximately a year of dialysis, which eventually started to take a toll on her body. Despite her suffering, she was always optimistic and kept a smile on her face and always maintained a spirit of hope. There are many precious memories we'd like to share about our dear sister, but time will not permit. Our family and friends will forever cherish the times we spent with Kimberly. No one is perfect, and Kimberly was no exception. But despite the challenges of life, she taught us all a beautiful lesson in how to make most of life in the midst of adversities. To all our aunts, uncles, cousins, nieces, and nephews, we would like to, Kimberly held you all close to her heart, and she loved you all unconditionally. Ugo, if you are hearing this, you brightened your aunt's life in what would be her last remaining days here on earth. It was noticeable that both of you had a special bond. On behalf of our family, we would like to take this opportunity to thank everyone for their support. However, and whatever you did for our sister, please know she appreciated everything. We will never forget you, Kim. May you rest in eternal peace in the arms of our Savior. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed. Very beautiful sentiments and memories shared. And of course, for each and every one of us, we thank God for that special relationship, those memories we would have had with Kimberly, and we know that she indeed was a light to so many of us, as mentioned in those thoughts and in those remembrances where she would post on WhatsApp chats and everyone would look forward to that. And I myself would receive calls when she didn't. You know, Kimberly didn't post this morning. Did you call her and ask her if she's all right? So we know that. And in true form, and I could see Kimberly as she worked with me, she would always tell me, you know, stop eating so late, you need to lose some weight. Make sure that you take good care of yourself and your health. And I would always forget my glasses in the car. And she would say, Rev, they'll wait for you. Go and get your glasses. So of course I forgot my glasses and I forgot the first hymn. So this is just to pay a tribute to Kimberly there. But we will put that hymn before Mikey does his prayer. And I think it's an appropriate place there. We're going to lift our voices in song. Let's sing together, Thy Word is a Lamp Unto My Feet. This program, these hymns selected by members of the family, requested by Kimberly herself. So let's sing together as we prepare our first scripture reading, as it is taken from the book of Psalms, and as we invite presiding elder Asha Mahabir to read for us after the hymn is sung.
Reading comes from Psalm 42, reading verses 1 to 4, after which we shall say the Gloria together. As a deer longs for flowing streams, so my soul longs for you, O God. My soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and behold thy face, the face of God? My tears have been my food day and night. While people say to me continually, where is your God? These things I remember as I pour out my soul, how I went with the throng and led them in procession to the house of God, with glad shouts and songs of thanksgiving, a multitude keeping festival. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, as it was in the beginning, it's now and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
If you know the hymn, feel free to sing along. Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. I sing because she's happy. I sing because she's free. For His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Let not your heart be troubled. His tender word I hear, and resting on His goodness, I lose my doubts and fears. Though by the path He leadeth, but one step I may see, His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. And I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free, for His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Whenever I am tempted, whenever clouds arise, when songs give place to sighing, when hope within me dies, I draw the closer to Him. From care He sets me free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. And I sing because I'm happy. I sing because I'm free. For His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me. Yes, I sing because I'm happy. I sing because she's free. For His eye is on the sparrow, and I know He watches me.
We're going to be led in our New Testament reading for this afternoon by Isabel Gangaram, after which we will lift our voices in song, and then I will invite our presiding elder, of the Kuva Balmain Pastoral Region to lead us in a prayer of thanksgiving. So Isabel will read for us from Philippians chapter 3, verses 10 to 16.
Scripture reading is taken from Philippians chapter 3, verses 10 to 16. All I want is to know Christ and to experience the power of his resurrection, to share in his sufferings and become like him in his death, in the hope that I myself will be raised from death to life. I do not claim that I have already succeeded or have already become perfect. I keep striving to win the prize for which Christ Jesus has already won me to himself. Of course, my friends, I really do not think that I have already won it. The one thing I do, however, is to forget what is behind me and to do my best, which is to reach ahead. So I run straight toward the goal in order to win the prize, which is God's call through Christ Jesus to the life above. All of us who are spiritually mature should have the same attitude. But if some of you have a different attitude, God will make this clear to you. However that may be, let us go forward according to the same rules we have followed until now. This is the word of God. Thanks be to God for his word.
So we lift our voices in song, after which we shall be led in prayer. What a friend we have in Jesus.
Jesus.
Beautiful. Thank you so much. Please be seated.
I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, King and Head of our church. I remember texting Reverend Damien a morning and saying, Reverend, I'm not seeing Kimberly on the chat. Is she? Do you think she's okay? And he said, I don't know. We could ask. Then we hear ping on the phone and Kimberly on the chat saying, I'm okay. And that was the concern that we had for always in the region, always trying to inquire, is it well with her? Let us come to God in prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, your word tells us to give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Jesus Christ for us. We bow in prayer even in circumstances that begs answers, where we pray that this cup is heavy and the wine sour. However, in acceptance we endure. Lord, we submit with thanksgiving, thankful for the daughter, the sister, or friends, Kimberly Rashuma, whose life and time was an example of humility and purpose. For being tested and found to be worthy. Thank you, Lord, for loving parents, sisters, for providing enough for them, even grateful for the loving time spent in play, in joys and in laughter. Thank you, Lord, for the circle of relatives and friends, for the support and camaraderie in ministry. We thank you, Lord, for allowing her the opportunity to partner with our ministers and other workers in our Presbyterian church, and even the principal and student of the St. Andrew's Theological College, and for her pastoral work sharing the message of love that her Savior Jesus Christ taught her. We praise you, great Redeemer, for every doctor, every nurse, every ambulance driver, every caregiver of the intensive care unit, ever vigilant in their duty of care. Kimberly brought joy to fellow patients through her prayers of healing and for message of submission, trusting in the promised victory. We thank you, Father, even for today, now, this moment when we celebrate her life, her walk with her Christ, who said to her, my yoke is easy and my burden light. The same Jesus Christ whose example we follow, whose teaching we practice, and whose blood was shed for our sins. Gracious God, we are thankful for her. Gracious God, we are thankful for the message that she would give to us, the sharing of that love and that fellowship, the joy of working with her, for the companionship which she offered, for the words of comfort which she gave to us, even though she needed it more, for the love that she shared. Dear God, we thank you. And for us loving spirit, we give you praise. Gracious God, Kimberly is absent now from the body, now present with our Lord in heaven. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. We pray to Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
We now invite Miss Simran Suhan to bless us and to lead us in dance as we prepare for a message of comfort.
say I. You must go die. Don't pass it, I. You must go die. Tumne na jaane kya sapne dikhaye. Tum paas aaye, you muskuraye. Tumne na jaane kya sapne dikhaye. Ab to mera dil jaake na sota hai. Kya karun aaye, kuch kuch hota hai. Kya karun aaye.
तुम पास आए, यूं मुस्कुराए, तुमने न जाने क्या सपने दिखाए, अब तो मेरा दिल जागे न सके, क्या करूं हाय, कुछ कुछ होता है, क्या करूं हाय, कुछ कुछ होता
very nice indeed. Let's give a little round of applause because we do appreciate that expression of who Kimberly is and how we remember it to be. I'm sure a lot of my colleagues who are sitting here are very jealous because they would have never had Kuch Kuch Hota Hai played or danced to before a sermon before, right? Yes. It is definitely an honor to be here this afternoon, and it is a difficult task to have prepared a message and to think about this occasion. Of course, Kimberly so very often, and especially within the last year, would ever so often remind me that this would be my task on this fateful day, and I would always make a joke of it and push it off and say, you're talking about next, what, 30, 40 years. But she knew the reality and she embraced and accepted that. And she still held on steadfast, firm and sure to her faith. That is who we celebrate today. Bow with me for a moment of prayer. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, we thank you for your word. For your word indeed provides comfort to us. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for your word and the role that it has played and continues to in the life of Kimberly. For she trusted in your word and she relied upon it. Your word got her through difficult times and challenges, times of celebration and triumph. Your word reminded her of the call that you placed upon her life for service. Your word dictated and led her to help so many. So today, O God, in this moment, this time where we celebrate her life, where we think of her departure from this side of eternity, and her victorious entrance into the next, into the promised place prepared for her, we turn to your word. And we ask, O God, that you bless us through your most holy word, that you bring to us that comfort and strength, especially, O God, the members of her family. Hear us, O God. Hear us and receive this prayer as we offer this through the Word made flesh, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. I am sure my colleagues, friends, Christian friends, will agree with me when we think about occasions such as these, and we think about a life like Kimberly's, and we think about her faith, her trust, and her hope in her Lord. And we recognize that moments like these are indeed bitter sweet. For we feel the sorrow and the grief of having to say goodbye on this side of eternity to a daughter, and a sister, a niece, a loved one, a friend. But we are thankful for her life, and we know that in faith that she has gone to be with her Lord. We give thanks for that. When the news came to me Tuesday morning, a little after 7 a.m., as I was driving my son to school, Reverend Robert Dinu called and gave me that message. And as I hung up the phone, I just said, "Oh, Kimberly." And my son right away picked up on that and said, "Kimberly, who's Kimberly?" And I reminded him of who she is. And he asked, "Why did you say, oh, Kimberly?" And I said, "Well, she's gone to meet Jesus." And my son is at an age and stage where he's trying to figure out facts, and he wants an explanation about anything, about everything. So he asked me the question, "So Kimberly going to meet Jesus, that's good, yes or no?" And see me driving the car thinking, that is such a profound theological question to ask. And I said, "It's a good thing. It's a good thing for her, because she is free from suffering and sickness. But for us, it doesn't feel so good just yet. We will come around to it. Because as our dear brother Mikey mentioned in his prayer, to be absent from the body is indeed to be present with the Lord. I first met Kimberly when she was beginning her process and thinking about joining the church. Well, met her in that mood that she was in. She told me about her surgery, and she was excited and said that she wants to become a minister. She wants to join the church. She wants to serve. This was at Mizpat, her home church. And that was amazing. And for her, you could have seen the excitement. Years later, we were very blessed in the Coover Balmain Pastoral Region to have her assigned to us as our student. And we met Kimberly in this capacity. The first event that I shared with her was a creche opening at Balmain Presbyterian School. And we were introduced to Kimberly, her poise, her comportment, her class, her graciousness, her gracefulness, her distinctive voice. And this started a journey with her where we experienced someone who was so compassionate and caring and concerned for others. Someone who wanted the best for her congregations. Someone who was straightforward, no nonsense, steadfast in her faith, trusting in God, and always and ever hopeful. When we did visitations, no matter what the situation would be, Kimberly would share with the families and always say, "Have faith in the Lord, trust in the Lord, have hope in the Lord." And preparing for this afternoon, I recognized this to be a sincere reflection of the testimony of her life. That was her ministry. That is what she lived. Psalm 42 that was read for us. The psalmist is writing and he's thinking about the changes. He's looking at what has happened. And he's questioning and he's asking, "Why am I so sad? Why do I feel distressed? I remember the good times, and I remember going to church and celebrations. And now look at where we are. Why am I so sad? Why am I so distressed?" But as the psalm continues, we see that he asks this about three times. And every time, in anguish and agony, he cries out and he asks, "Why am I so sad? Why am I so distressed?" He quickly resolves that emotion by saying, "But I will put, and I will put my hope, my trust in God." That is what Kimberly did. Through her many challenges, her hope and her trust was in God, and she brought that to her ministry and her service to each and every one of us. A little more than a year or so, when unfortunately she no longer carried that status of student minister, Hoover Balmain Pastoral Region, without fear or favor, declared that she will always be our student. She will always be one of us. And she was never removed from our session chat, our local board. And that is why Mikey remarked, we were speaking about Kimberly on a chat and asking if she was all right. And she saw that and she responded, yes, I'm okay. She indeed became one of us. Serving the region, reaching out to those who were shut in by and through those messages. Positivity, simplicity, and humility. A true servant of Christ, who even though at times when she felt distressed, she conveyed that faith of having hope in her Lord. I remember a year or so ago when we had that conversation, and she said what was taking place. She fearlessly said, I don't know why this is happening or this has happened to me. And she even quite remarkably commented and said, even if I were to remain a student, I may never live to be ordained, but I want to serve. I want to serve my God, my Lord, and his people. But she knew the truth of Philippians 3 that was read to us. She wanted to experience the Lord and share his goodness and his glory with others. And she did just that. She wanted to run her race, and oh, what a race. She battled and she fought through her struggles with a determination and a dedication that cannot be compared, because her hope was in the Lord and she wanted to just experience him even in her trying times, saying, I know that the Lord's grace is sufficient for me, quoting the apostle himself. Positivity, simplicity, and humility. Kimberly shared and as a team led through the 2 years of lockdown, this COVID pandemic. She read and she prayed, she preached, and she impacted on so many throughout the world as they joined in for our Zoom services. And she fulfilled her call to ministry. And she did what God called her to do. Many who heard of her stepping from this side of eternity to the next called us and said that they would always remember her voice, her infectious laugh, her wonderful demeanor. And that we see as a mature Christian who indeed has achieved and accomplished what her God has set her here to accomplish. I want to share something quite fascinating for me. On Wednesday morning, the day after Kimberly went to be with the Lord, my son, Evan, he approached me and he asked if we could do one of the Facebook devotions. Yes, he asked me to do it. And I said, sure. So I went to the Bible app and I looked to see what was the reading for the day. The reading for the day was from 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 8. And I thought, all right, great, let's do this. And we did the message. And something about that passage started to remain with me. And I went back to my notes, and I'm sure, I don't know if your family would remember this. I went back to my notes, and for Kimberly's birthday prayer meeting last day, remember this? I decided to do something I saw my father do, and I told Kimberly, I said, look, as I got to the prayer meeting, I said, tell me what your favorite Bible passage is. And here I am expecting to hear Jeremiah 29, verse 11, or Psalm 23, or something like that. Kimberly looks at me and without skipping a beat says, 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 to 11. And I look at her and I say, all right, no, Kimberly, be serious, because nobody says and answers like that. And she says, no, really, 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 7 to 11. And I thought about how fascinating that was, that the Bible app would have had that portion of scripture on that Wednesday. And I thought about it. And I remember asking Kimberly to share that passage with us for her birthday. And I want to read it for you. For this passage is the sermon. This passage is the message that we can take with us. That passage says to us, Kimberly's favorite passage. The end of all things is near. You must be self-controlled and alert to be able to pray. Above everything, love one another earnestly, because love covers over sins. Open your homes to each other without complaining. Each one, as a good manager of God's different gifts, must use for the good of others the special gift that they have received from God. Those who preach must preach God's messages. Those who serve must serve with the strength that God gives them, so that in all things praise may be given to God through Jesus Christ, to whom belong glory and power forever and ever. Amen. When we think about the caliber of the person who we celebrate today, we think about her faith, her steadfast hope and trust in the God who called her to this life and who led her to serve him in whatever capacity. And whatever was her challenge or difficulty, she remained positive. And we too are called to do just that. Kimberly exemplified that faith, that trust in him. Today, as we think of her life and celebrate who she is, gone to be with the Lord, we must know. Continue to serve. Continue to love one another. Continue to be reminded that love conquers and covers sin. Continue to revel in the life that he has won for us here on this side of eternity and the victory that we have received through him from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As we continue as a family and as friends, as a church, let us do just that. Trusting in God through our trials and our challenges. And let us always remember Kimberly, ordained by God. She fulfilled her call. She has gone to be with him. I want to end by sharing with you. Now, I keep mentioning Evan because, as Kerry reminded me before we started, I had to stop Kimberly from buying gifts for Evan. Because every time and every occasion, every Sunday she saw him, gifts and snacks and all these different treats. And Kimberly bought this book for Evan, a prayer book that we read together every night. And sometimes, of course, Evan, he asks for a couple more prayers from this book that his auntie Kimberly bought for him. So we will remember her legacy always. But I want us, as I close, to listen to this prayer that's from this beautiful book that Kimberly bought. Let us pray. O Christ Jesus, when all is darkness and when we feel our weakness and helplessness, give us the sense of your presence, your love, and your strength. Help us to have perfect trust in your protecting love and strengthening power. so that nothing may frighten or worry us. For living close to you, we shall see your hand, your purpose, your will, through all things. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, as we continue in prayer, we give you thanks and praise, O God, for the life of our dearly beloved, your dearly beloved, Kimberly. We give you thanks, Heavenly Father, for all that in her that was and is good and kind and faithful, committed, dedicated, and devoted, for her selfless service, for the call that you have placed upon her life, and for how she was able to use her ministry, her life, to lift others, to help others to know you. We thank you, Heavenly Father. We thank you that in this life, she experienced so much love. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for her family, for those who always stood with her, encouraged her, supported her, for those who held her when she was weak and lifted. Appointments, who was always there for her and with her. We thank you, O God, for the love and the concern of a mother. We ask, Heavenly Father, for blessings for her parents, this difficult time of saying farewell to their firstborn child. Let them know, O God, and hold on to that same hope with that steadfast faith that they will all be reunited one with the other, and that their Kimberly rests with you, O Heavenly Father. We pray, O God, for her sisters, Kelly and Kerry. Be with them and unite them, Heavenly Father. Continue to strengthen them and be with them as they continue in this life and as they remember their elder sister. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, for all the relatives and friends, we ask for your comfort, we ask for your strength, and we ask, Heavenly Father, as today we celebrate the legacy of love and hope and faith that Kimberly has shown and demonstrated and now left with us, that peace that she embraced. Let us feel and know and show that in our lives and in our earthly walk. We thank you, O God, for her passion. We thank you for all. Be with us as a family. Be with us in all that we do. And hear our prayers as we offer this, the name of our blessed Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The Lord and Savior who has given to us victory over the casket, over the grave. And hear us, O God, as we unite together, as a family. And as we say the blessed and very words that he himself has taught us to pray. Let it bring comfort to us, O God, as we pray and say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. May God bless us and be with us all as we conclude our worship service here. We will remain standing for the benediction and for the recessional as the casket is taken to the doors of the church. We're reminded as well that the interment at Guide's crematorium is a private one. So we want to take that time here to pay our last respects and to meet with one another. So the family will get their time there. So I was just told that the family has requested that we open the floor. Yes? Yeah? So we'll open the floor for a few minutes. Yeah? So if there's anyone who feels so moved to come up and share a memory or a few thoughts, please feel free to do so. And we don't want, of course, to go on for too long as we have to go to the crematorium. So we'll sing the hymn. And then I'll ask you to take your seats and we'll open the floor for a few moments. Yeah, let's stand as we sing together. Very much, please be seated, and we shall have an open floor at this time for anybody who would like to come up and share a few words. I'll invite the past principal of the St. Andrew's Theological College and someone who would have been under his tenure principal to Kimberley while she was a student, Reverend Dr. Randallson.
Thank you, Reverend Damien. I won't be long, but I share in the grief of the family. So on my own behalf, my wife, my daughter, who was always embraced by Kimberley whenever they met, I am so sorry. I've known Kimberley for a long time through her cousin Denise. And within the church, you know, there's always a friendship, a fraternity, a togetherness. So I was principal of the college when Kimberley entered ministry. And I think it was Mikey who mentioned her humility. That was one thing that stood out in her personality. Part of our responsibility at the Theological College was to not only train and educate future church leaders, but also have a sense of the sincerity of call. Being called to ministry is no easy matter. You don't get up in the morning and decide to be a minister. The call to ministry is often after some time of struggle, inner struggle, most importantly. And Kimberly had that call. Whatever her limitations, she always kept a positive face. Even to encourage me when I had challenges at the college. And she never gave up. She always had something positive to say. I think with all the episodes of moments of inspiration, we have something alive to remember her by. So to mom and dad, sisters, the church workers, all of us who interacted with Kimberly at some point in time, we are here for you. Damien knows where to find us. So the peace of the Lord be with you. Thank you.
Good afternoon, friends. I actually have a comment, not from myself, but the Right Reverend Joy Abdul Mohan wishes to extend her condolences on behalf of the Synod of the Presbyterian Church of Trinidad and Tobago. She was here earlier but was not able to remain to offer these words of condolences to you. For myself personally, I will regret not having another female minister to work alongside. She always spoke strongly about being a young woman and what that meant for her in ministry, and her voice will truly be missed. My condolences to the family and to the friends. Thank you.
Family in Christ, I must say a pleasant evening to one and all, Reverend Damien and the whole body of Christ, Reverend Summer, Reverend Sinara, Lubekan, Reverend Senior, and the whole body of Christ. I am Reverend Patrick Webb of the Anglican Commune, my parish church, St. Stephen's in Princetown. Approximately 5 years ago, I met this wonderful young lady. Kimberly, when I entered the St. Andrew's Theological College as a student, and I must say we developed, I would say, a special relationship. And I think that special relationship could only have been connected through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And throughout all the years, she was always one who supported me on my journey to ministry. Today I stand humbly before you as I give God thanks for Kimberly, the passion and the love that she always expressed when we communicated. She was always one that would make you feel she had a sense of belonging. You know, I really thank God for her. And in a conversation, in our communication, she always shared the love that she has for her parents and her siblings. Daddy, I met in my early years at SADC, and today I was fortunate, even in this circumstance, to share that love in meeting mommy and her other siblings. So I just want to thank God for her, for Kimberly, and the opportunity for meeting her. And I pray mommy and daddy, Kerry and the whole family, God's comforting spirit upon you, and may Kimberly's soul rest in peace and rise in God's glory. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And together, as we pronounce that final benediction, and as we remain standing for the recession, I invite us to bow our heads in prayer. God Creator, hear our prayers, and give us a vision of your purpose, and such assurance of your love and strength that we may ever hold fast the hope which is in the risen Christ. Be with us, O God. May God bless us and keep us. May God's face shine upon us and be gracious unto us all. And may God look upon us with kindness and give us his peace. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. And may the blessing of this God, our Creator, Christ, our Savior, and the Holy Spirit, our Comforter, be with you, the members of Kimberly's family, with all of us who hold her dear, now and always. It is taken to the doors of the church. There will be that time for viewing. So I'll invite the pallbearers to come forward, and if any of Kimberly's colleagues would like to be viewing here, right here in front? In front here? And then we go to the. Okay, sorry. All right. Sorry. So we'll do the viewing here, and then we'll go. Sorry about that. So I invite us to then take our seats here, and we will have the viewing inside.
Thank you. Drowning in an endless sea, takes Safe and sound. keep me close, safe and sound.
Take some time and stay with me.
Safe and sound. Safe and sound.